Good morning, Move Church. It's a little bit different up here this morning. We've got a lot of people out. We're going to worship our God this morning. If you guys would stand with us.
Oh, I heard thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I heard your tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. And I've seen many searching for searching for rest, only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways, to it's a love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think of you. Still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by. To I am, to I am, to I am, you're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, who you are, I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Coming
deserve. Still you give yourself away.
I think about fatherhood, I think about my heavenly father. And for so many people, when we talk about God being a good God, they cannot reference that because they didn't have a good earthly example. And if that's you, I'm telling you, I pray that you would open up your heart. My prayer today is that God will show you just in a unique way his love for you. The scripture says, Jesus said, if two sparrows are sold for a pence and not one of them falls to the ground, lest the Father knows about it. How much more valuable are you than many sparrows? Scripture says that the very hairs of your head are numbered. Scripture says if men who are evil know how to give good gifts to their children, how much more does your Father in heaven know how to give good things to you? His love for you goes beyond your comprehension. I don't really think on this earth we will ever be able to fully understand how much God loves us. But He wants to reveal Himself to you. He wants to reveal Himself, His love to you in a way that you can understand that. So this is my prayer today. Would you bow your head just for a moment? And I'm going to ask once again, Father, would you show your love? Would you let it be a word? Would it let it be a vision even? Lord, would you let it be a feeling? Lord, some way, somehow, breakthrough. Breakthrough, Lord God, our misconceptions of you. Breakthrough our false realities of your love toward us because of our experiences that we've had. Lord God, speak to us your love. Show us today, every person, Lord God, let them know how much you love them. We love you. And Lord God, today, if we know more of your love for us, we would be able to love you back more. And that's the way we are, Lord. You say that we cannot even come to you unless your Spirit draws. So, Lord, I pray these, as Chad gets it back into this next song, Lord, just let your Spirit flow, move, minister your love in the way that will communicate it to your people. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for this day, God. Thank you for everything you do for us, Lord, on a daily basis. We thank you for our church, God. Lord, thank you for Pastor Bobby. We pray today, God, as he brings your word, that you would just speak through him, God, that you would open eyes to see and ears to hear you. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy, for your grace, for your righteousness, God. We love you, God. We thank you. We pray all of these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Welcome to Move Church. You can be seated. We are so glad you're with us this morning. So glad that you're watching with us online. If you are watching with us online, we believe God's going to move through your house the same way he's going to move through this church building this morning. If you're a first-time guest, thank you for joining us. We're so glad you're here. We hope you feel welcome. We hope you feel loved. There should be a connection card in the seat back in front of you. We want you guys just to fill that out and drop it in our giving box on your way out of service this morning. But before we continue with our service and before Brother Bobby comes up, we have a short clip, a short video in honor of Father's Day and to kind of recap our men's conference that we had just a few weeks ago. So let's take a look at that.
We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains. We were made to be courageous.
Start being the man God has called you to be.
So some of us were asked to give a little testimony about what we went through that night and that afternoon. I just happened to be the first one to grab the mic, so. I get to go first, I guess. The week leading up to that men's night, God laid on Angie's heart for her to relay to me that I needed to step up more, make a bigger role, play a bigger part in our Christian walk, leading our children, being the best example that I could be. And it was emphasized not only during the preparation for that night, for that meal, with the fellowship that we had that night, David Maxwell, when he got up to speak, some of the things that he talked about were verbatim to what Angie told me that week. And some of the things that, it was just a big God moment that night for me. A confirmation and a reaffirmation of the things that us as men and fathers, whether you have children or not, you're still a father. Every man in this church is a role model to somebody. So we all, as men, need to step up. We need to take control of our Christian walk ourselves and become better examples for our wives and our children and the people that are new Christians in their walk of life. So that's what I got from that weekend, and I'm going to pass it over to David.
Happy Father's Day, everyone. I'm not too good at this talking stuff, but I'm David Blackwell. We're sending our new to move church, and this is our new home. We love it, and great place. And before the men's, I'll talk about the men's ministry, then I'll give you all a short testimony myself, personal testimony of not-so-perfect fathers, you know, and how they can, you know, even though you're trying, we're trying right now, you know, to be a perfect father. There's only one perfect father, and I can say I'm not the perfect father. I'm still a work in progress. We've only been here, visited a couple of times, said, let me go, you know, small church, probably 4 or 5 people there at this men's meeting, you know. I said, I'm even going to show up about 15 minutes till. And I just ride by and see, was I surprised? I was wrong. I got here, I said, I better get a parking spot. It was one of the better men's ministries that I've been in. There was young boys, old men, you know, and I'm sitting here looking at this right now. I see Charlie Thornton, I see Samuel, you know, I see Don, you know, all these folks that have been, you know, I've seen them at the men's conference. Fantastic fellowship, we needed that. A lot of the guys are not Sunday morning Christians. You know, we can fake a whole lot of stuff on Sunday morning, but Monday when we go duck hunting or deer hunting, you know, that's when you're the real Christian. That's where I want to be involved, you know. So we had a lot of fun. We enjoyed, you know, our fellowship. We got in here. I sit there and watch the guys in this church raise their hands, something they may not do or, you know, open up. We need each other. And what I want to challenge y'all, and I'm going to tell y'all a story here in just a second, is we're not perfect. You know, we're not the perfect fathers. We failed, you know what I mean? But these older guys, even younger guys, like Charlie Thornton, he's my mentor. I'm looking at him right now. He may not think he is, but he is. I'm watching him. Lee Kendrick was my mentor. You know, people like that was my mentor. They're not all perfect dads. I'm going to tell y'all a little story about me. I lived at Robin Hood. I don't know if y'all know where that's at or not, out from Brandon, a little redneck place. I'm redneck too, if y'all know. I grew up out there. I had a great dad, but he didn't hunt or fish with me, you know. There was this guy up the road named Charles Warren. He was a devout Catholic. He was also an alcoholic, you know. So he took up time with me. You know, he was not perfect. Not even, he died of liver, you know, disease. He drank so much. He wasn't drunk. He's alcoholic. But he taught this country boy how to shoot, you know, do a trot line or whatever. And I survived, you know. But what he did instilled in me, see, all his, God filtered that drinking out. I never drank. Lord knows I don't need no liquor, you know. But this guy instilled in me hunting, fishing, mentoring people. You know, and that's what I challenge these guys. He took me bird hunting, and that got into me. I love anything outdoors. I love it. And I know I'm about to run over my 2 minutes or 3 minutes. But he taught me a lot of stuff my real dad didn't. You know, he mentored me. And I challenge you guys, find somebody. You may not be perfect. God works through the little stuff, you know. But that guy teaching me to bird hunt, squirrel hunt, I have touched. And it's not me. To God be the glory. I have taken several hundred guys duck hunting. And when it's duck season, we're going to go. You know, that's where we pray. That's my church. You know, we lead the boys. And you're an example. I have so many boys that are grown that want me to come back and talk to them or take them duck hunting. You know, but the key thing is, be involved. In this church, mentor. You may not have it all together, but mentor somebody. And I love you guys. Appreciate it.
All right, so our next men's meeting is a duck hunt. Then we'll go on a deer hunt, a dove hunt, a pig hunt, whatever we got to do. Right, Mr. Maxwell? All right. So Mr. Mike asked me to come up here and say something, probably just because I'm the best looking on the security team. You know, if I could dance like Papa Charlie, I would. So, but I'll save that for another day. But, you know, looking at the videos, it kind of looked like government work. You know, one person cooking while everybody else was watching. And we're all eating, so I am a teacher. So, it was neat. You know, you show up, and everybody's grilling. Some people are, you know, preparing the steaks, seasoning the steaks, grilling the steaks. You know, we didn't have the right utensils because, you know, the women weren't involved. So, you know. I got sent to the Dollar Tree because it was closer, and I came back with something. Well, we forgot something else, so we said, hey, Benny, can you go to the Dollar Tree? So he came back with something, but we got it all worked out. It was a great time of fellowship. Now, my favorite quote from the King of Heaven is, what man is a man that does not make the world better? So, when you think about that, as men, we're either making the world better. If we're not, we're helping it become worse because the world is in trouble. And so, Chad, thank you for coming up here and leading. We appreciate it, you know, to come in and step up and use his talents to help lead us into worship. you know, that's a role model for the church. You know, and coming here, like it was already been said, young men coming here and watching men, walls being torn down, hands being raised. And so that's what it's all about. And so if you did not get a chance to make it to the last one, please come. You will be changed, and you will be used to go out and to make disciples.
Can we give those guys just one more round of applause? I'm so thankful for all the great dads that we have at this church that are involved here and that make an impact here at Move Church and that make an impact on society. I think that's our call from the Word is to be different, right? So before Brother Bobby comes up here and before we get into our message, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today. Lord, we want to thank you for everything that you're doing here at Move Church. We want to thank you for everything that you're doing in these people's lives here at Move Church. Lord, we ask that your presence fall down in this place this morning, God. Rain your presence in here, Lord. Fill each and every row. Lord, fill each and every heart this morning, God. Lord, we want to thank you for the blessings that you've already put on our lives, even if we have not been able to see them yet. Lord, we want to thank you for everything that you're doing, everything that you will do, and everything that you've promised to do. In your name we pray. Amen.
And I really appreciate Mike and the security team for putting that night on. Come on, let's give it up for them. Big round of applause. That was a lot of hard work. And look, even if we didn't have the right utensils for us guys, we know how to get meat to mouth. That's all. It don't matter. We'll tear it up. It was a lot of fun. Dads, I hope you got your little happy this morning. Pork and cheese. How can you beat that? Pork and cheese kebabs, and you didn't, there'll be plenty if you want to join us. As a matter of fact, there's probably enough back there for everybody that's breathing to have some, but good time of fellowship this morning. Happy Father's Day. Dad, I just feel the need, and I really believe the Lord is putting on my heart to affirm our men. And men, you don't have a lot of great examples in the world, especially from Hollywood. And I'm so thankful for the men of this church. We have some fabulous men in this church. And would you help me give, ladies, would you help me give them a big round of applause? Thank y'all. Thank y'all for being men that can inspire others, that can, others that can look up to you because they are looking up to you. So thank you. For that. And I know we're all growing. I think that was David that said that we're nobody's perfect other than our Father in heaven. But we're growing and we want to help other people out. So thank you guys. Before I get in the message this morning, I want Katrina and Alexis, would you come up? And Nikki, is Nikki here? This Nikki's serving. Okay. So we want to be praying for these special ladies that are going on a missions trip next Saturday, I believe, for the Dominican Republic. Would you come up? Papa Charlie and Miss Janie, where are you at? You're sitting in a different place. Papa Charlie's here. Come on up, Papa Charlie. I want you to help me pray for them, if you would. They're going to be spending some time in the Dominican Republic. And, that's right. You just take your time. And Alexis is working in the back. She's coming, maybe. Oh, she went to go get Nikki. All right. And we want to say a prayer for God's covering on them as they're having a great time on this trip. As we're waiting for them, would you stand up, please? And would you just greet somebody around you, shake their hand, give a high five, a fist bump, a hug? Good to see you in the house. Good to see you in the house. Come on up, Alexis, if you would. And is Nikki coming? That's okay if we can't get her. We'll just pray where she's at, okay? Papa Charlie, help me pray. Would you stretch a hand toward these ladies and keep Nikki in mind? Father, I thank you, Lord God, for your goodness, yes. your grace. I thank you for this opportunity yes. you're giving them. Yes. Lord, I pray that everything would go well. Lord, for Nikki, we're praying for her too. Lord, that everything would go well emotionally with her health, with the plans, all the details, with the ministry. Let your anointing flow through them. Lord, I pray that they're blessed and changed as you use them. Thank you, Lord, you will use them, and lives will be forever changed. And, Lord, we can't wait to hear about the good testimonies. Lord, we thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Ooh, God bless you. There you are. We included you in on it. Give it up for them. Give them a round of applause. Man. Come on, yes, go ahead. Yeah. Nikki, come on back. We're going to put a double prayer on you. Come on. Papa Charlie, come on.
We're going to lay some blessings on you.
Come on. Go ahead, Papa Charlie.
Lord Jesus, we come to you and we lift these three ladies up. I know that when they make this trip, their lives will be totally changed.
Yes, God.
Because what that does for you is that gives you a sense of compelled to help the people. Not just in Africa, but in this church and in where they go to work. So, Lord, I just lay a special blessing on them that you would lift them up. I ask for love. I ask for mercy.
Yes.
Most of all, I ask for Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you, Papa Charlie. Awesome. Praise God. You can be seated. Man. We have quite a few leaders out of town today, and want to say thanks to Chad for leading us into worship. And I don't know, somebody said that, but we really appreciate God has blessed us with so many wonderful leaders that not only are capable but anointed. So thank you. And all right, I want to jump right in. We are looking at the Beatitudes of Jesus. They are the opening of his first message that we have an account of. And these are attitudes and perspectives that Jesus said we can have, and we should have, if we won't be happy. That word happy is more than just that feeling that comes and goes when the circumstances are right. It's a deeper happiness. It's a joy. It's a peace. Knowing that God has things planned and purposed for us and he's got it worked out, that's that kind of deep blessedness that comes when you apply these things to your life. So last week was our first message. We looked at the beatitude that says, blessed are those who know they are poor in spirit. So we looked at the right spiritual perspective that we should have. And today we're going to pick up the second one. And our text is Matthew 5. I'll read that verse leading up to it. Of Matthew 5, it says, Jesus saw the crowds and went up on a hill where he sat down. His disciples gathered around him, and he began to teach them. Happy are those who know they are spiritually poor. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. And this is the one we're going to get into today. Very countercultural. When you read it, it is like, that doesn't make sense to me. And how many of you understand that God's laws are different than man's laws, that God's ways are higher than our ways? And look what he says. Happy are those who mourn. God will comfort them. So we're going to be looking at that today. The title is, Happy Are Those Who Look to God in Trouble. Happy are those who look to God in trouble, when they're going through hard times. A lady at the gas pump this week getting gas for my lawnmower, she said, sir, can you help me with gas? I said, ma'am, I can't even help myself. Good luck. No, no. No, I did help her a little bit. She just said, I'm trying to get to North Jackson, and she was in Morton, and happened to have a $10 bill. It's like, well, that'll get you 2 gallons. And it gets you to North Jackson, maybe. It's hard times for many people. trouble for many people. Some of you may be here today, and it's more than just a hard time. It's a grieving time. It's a mourning time. The Lord is going to speak to your heart today. And we're going to learn what it really means to be happy in Christ, okay? If you want, let me pray for you. Thank you, God, today that you have a plan and an agenda. It's wonderful. Lord, we're here today to learn from you. Your Spirit is here. That's all that we need. And we ask you to speak to us. Lord, do a work. I'm asking today that those that are just going through it, that they get a hold of this happiness that you promise us. Lord, God, let us apply it to our lives. Now, Lord, speak to our hearts. Church, let's pray it together. Lord, speak to my heart. Change my life in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're watching online, we welcome you. We wish you were here and come when you can, but let's make them feel welcome. Would you give it up for them, please? We all have had bad days. Anybody had a bad day this week? All right. This brother had a bad day. And as the story goes, a man was working on his motorcycle on his patio, and his wife was in the kitchen. The man was racing the engine on his motorcycle, and somehow the motorcycle slipped into gear. The man, still holding on to the handlebars, was dragged through the glass patio door and ran into the dining room. He crashed through the patio door, and the motorcycle dumped him onto the floor inside the house. The wife, hearing the crash, ran into the dining room and found her husband laying on the floor, cut up and bleeding. The motorcycle laying next to him and the patio door shattered. The wife ran to the phone and summoned an ambulance. Because they lived on a fairly large hill, the wife went down the several flights of long steps to the street to direct the paramedics to her husband. After the ambulance arrived and transported her husband to the hospital, the wife uprighted the motorcycle and pushed it outside. Seeing that the gas had spilled on the floor, the wife used some paper towels to blot up the gasoline, then threw them in the toilet. The husband was treated at the hospital and was released to come home. After arriving home, he looked at the shattered patio door and the damage done to the motorcycle. He became very despondent, went into the bathroom, sat on the toilet, and smoked a cigarette. After finishing the cigarette, he flipped it between his legs and the toilet bowl. While he was still seated, his wife, who was in the kitchen, heard a loud explosion and her husband screaming. She ran into the bathroom and found her husband lying on the floor again. His pants had been blown off, and he was suffering burns on his lower extremities, can I say? His wife ran to the phone and called for an ambulance. The same ambulance crew was dispatched, and the wife met them at the street. The paramedics loaded the husband on the stretcher and began carrying him to the street. While they were going down the stairs to the street, accompanied by the wife, one of the paramedics asked her how the husband had burned himself. She told them, and the paramedics started laughing so hard, one of them tipped the stretcher and dumped the husband out. He fell down the remaining steps and broke his arm. So you think you had a bad day. That's a bad day. We all have bad days. And the problem that we have sometimes is that if we're not careful, bad days can grow into bad weeks. And bad weeks can grow into bad months. And before you know it, your life can slip into this season of just bad. And Jesus wants to help us if that would describe you today in your life. Jesus wants to comfort you. The scripture says these things, Jesus said, these things I've spoken to you, that in life you may have peace. Excuse me, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And Jesus wants you to be an overcomer in every area of your life. In Jesus, if you're taking notes, in Jesus there is comfort for every hurt and joy for every pain. I want to say that again. In Jesus, there is comfort for every hurt and joy for every pain. God loves working in the broken places. Pastor, you don't understand all that I've been through. No, I don't. But you don't understand what I've been through. And I know Jesus will work through those areas where he will comfort you so you can have joy and peace and be whole. And that brings that happiness, that deep satisfaction that God is in control of my life. There's favor on my life. I am blessed. And if you're having a hard time saying, I have God's favor and I am blessed, hear me today. God wants to change that for you before you walk out of the doors of this church. There is favor for you. There is blessings for you. God's got good things planned for you. So let's let him do a good work in us. The scripture says, Psalms 30, verse 5, weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. There are seasons of darkness, times that we have to go through things that are really difficult. But if you look to the sun, S-O-N, that darkness has to leave because light will shine on you. There's joy in the morning. When God begins to shine on your life as he brings you out of that darkness, there is joy. Darkness can't stay when the sun is shining, amen? And there's joy in the morning. I think it's time for somebody to have their joy back. The danger that we have is that sometimes those dark seasons, we prolong them. We begin to think wrong during those times. We think that God caused it. Maybe we blame God. For whatever reason, we have wrong thinking, and we quit looking toward the sun. We don't look to him for that comfort, and that dark season lasts longer than it should. And it should have been over a long time ago. Now, I understand some things are really hard, and there is a process of grieving that we need to go through. It's God's design for us to find emotional healing. So don't feel bad about grieving when it's something that's really hard. But you got to go through the process. Look into Jesus, and he will bring you through it all. There is a time of healing, though. There is a time of joy. You don't have to feel bad about being happy again. There is joy for you. There is comfort for you in Christ. Don't think wrong in times of trouble. In times of trouble, many times we think wrong. There's some ways, just the three of them I want to give you, three ways that we think wrong. If you're taking notes, the first one is this. We think bad things shouldn't happen to good people. We think bad things should never happen to good people. As a matter of fact, what's a little bit more dangerous is that we don't think bad things should happen to Christian people. And if we think that way, we're not reading the Bible. There's some bad things that happen to really good people. Jesus, I read it just a moment ago, he made us a promise in John 16, 33. It says, in this world, you will have trouble. Jesus said, you will have trouble, but we can take heart because he has already overcome the world. And because he has, we can also. We're not exempt from trouble, because we belong to the Lord. We, as a matter of fact, trouble usually is a good sign that you're doing something right. One thing we know in times of trouble, we're not exempt from it, but we are promised that God will be with us to bring us through it every time. Psalms 46 says this, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. I love that, don't you? That when I'm going through it, that, oh, God, you're there. Thank you. Oh, you're here. Oh, you're all around me. You're ever present with me when I'm going through hard times. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though the gas prices rise up to $10 a gallon, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. But even if you should suffer for what it... Oh, that's another verse. I got so happy reading that, I thought it went on. So there is comfort for you no matter how bad the things get. Now, is trouble hard? Yes, trouble is hard. Do we want trouble? No, we don't want trouble. But when those things happen to us, we must understand God is up to something. He is with us. He will bring us through it. But sometimes bad things happen. Many times bad things happen to good people. Maybe one of the reasons, I know one of the reasons is this. Some of the greatest testimonies of faith come when a believer experiences something that's really difficult and they refuse to back away from their faith. They give God glory through it all. That's an incredible testimony. I was talking to our overseer, Pastor Eugene Green, and he has really been struggling. Would y'all continue to pray for him? And I know you will. We're believing for a complete miracle for him, for new lungs. But he said, I will not quit believing. And as we're having our conversation, usually I talk to him about every other week or so, said, Pastor Eugene, let me tell you, I want you, he's not able to travel, he's not able to come. I said, I want you to do a video message for us on a Sunday morning because I want to hear, I want our people to hear from someone who's going through it, who is still standing strong for Jesus. See, that's the people I want to listen to. I want to hear somebody walking through it and are so secure in their faith, they can teach me something. They can teach us something, right? That's the people that inspire us. That's the people that give God glory. That's the people that's a test. I want to hear from them. And I think he's going to do that. We're going to rejoice with him. We're going to still believe for him for that miracle. But it's a testimony. When others see that kind of faith, it's a witness that God is real. Even though you cannot see him, he is alive and in control. Anybody can praise him when things are going good. I mean, anybody can rejoice during those times, but what about the people that don't get the answer and that are keep believing? And the next time you see them, nothing has changed. As a matter of fact, maybe it's gotten a little worse, but they say, God is faithful. He will bring me through this. That's the kind of folks that give God glory. And I want to be that kind of person. What about you? 1 Peter says this, but even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened, but in your hearts revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. Why are you still believing and you're going through this hard time? Be ready to tell them. They're looking for the answer. They are looking. I think eyes are on that person that says that they're a Christian and that they believe God's favor is on their life and they're blessed. When they go through it, every eye is on them. And God will bring comfort. God will bring deliverance. He promises that. Another wrong way we think is this. We think trouble means something is wrong. We think trouble means something is wrong with us, with our relationship with God. And I said this just a moment ago, a lot of times for the Christian, trouble means you're doing something right. Listen to this statement. When you're walking the same way as the devil, you never have to face it. How many of you, when you decided to devote your life to God, make that stand for Christ, how many of you the next few days you thought, man, it's just... Man, the roses were going to bloom, the birds were going to sing. and things got worse. Anybody experience some worse after that? You just broke up with the devil. That's what happened. You're going opposite directions of him now. You're on the other side. Praise the Lord for that. So trouble for the Christian usually means that you're causing trouble for hell. But many believers think it wrong when it comes to trouble. Some think this. They think that God must be punishing me for a past sin that I did. Now, God does punish his children because he loves us, the scripture says. But from my experience, if there is a punishment, that usually is after, right after, close to the sin, and it's always to teach us and to pull us closer to the Lord. So he's not punishing you from some past sin that you've done a long time ago. The scripture says that when he forgives you, he throws it in the sea of forgetfulness. And I am so glad that I don't have to receive punishment for what I did way back when. That's not the reason. Don't let the devil put that in your mind. Well, some may think, well, since I'm going through this trouble, maybe God doesn't love me as much as he loves others. They don't seem to be going through that. Don't let the devil trip you up in that. Romans 2 says this, for God shows no partiality, no arbitrary favoritism, the Amplified says. With him, one person is not more important than the other. So God is not punishing you from the past. God doesn't love you less. When you're going through times of trouble, don't allow Satan to sell you that. If you believe those things, the devil will sell you a whole lot more, right? Romans 2:11, I just read that. So many times when we face trouble, it means that God wants to develop something within us. He wants to do something in us. There is no other way for your faith to grow and your godly character to be developed than when it's tested by trouble. Man, I wish it was some other way. I wish there was an easier way for my faith to grow. I wish there was an easier way for my character to be developed, don't you? But the Bible is very clear. Look at James 1, it says this, consider it pure joy, my brothers, and I think it says, and sisters, yes, when you face trials of many kinds, Pastor, you got that memorized. Yeah, because I've had to learn that when I go through hard times, there's a reason for it. When you face trials of many kinds, because you know, see, there's that thinking, that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, and perseverance must run its course. I think that translation says finish its work, so that you may be mature, complete, not lacking anything. Do we want to grow up as Christians? Yes. Do we want to be great men and women of God? Yes. You will have to go through times of trials. We don't want it. We don't. But when it does come, the Bible says you got to be careful how you think. That I'm going through this for a reason. It's not for those false things that Satan wants me to believe. He said, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. You got to keep the right thinking when you're going through trouble. Another wrong way we think is this. We can skip that verse. Third way is this. We think we know what's best. You know, I'm usually overconfident in my cognitive abilities. Why are you laughing? I think I got more brain power than I really do. Is anybody else sort of like that? And I think I know the answers to things. If people would just do it my way. Yeah, I'm an answer kind of guy. I have to be very careful as a pastor. I don't do it quite so much more as I used to, but as a preacher, because Patty would tell me something, and I would automatically have three things you need to do. Boom, boom, boom. Take care of it. And she got to say, well, as she was telling me her problem, she would say, now, I'm not looking for a sermon. I can come up with some three things. Hey, this is what you do. Boom, boom, boom. But, you know, many times we think we can tell God that. God, this is what you need to do. And when it comes to our own life, we think, God, if you'll let me control this thing for just a moment, we can take care of this. And if we're not careful, we can think that we know better than God. Well, it just don't make sense why he's allowing this to happen. He's God. He knows better than you and me. And when we're going through those times where it doesn't make sense, we trust in his love for us. God, I don't know why you're allowing this to happen. When you can just speak one word, we know for Pastor Eugene, God could speak one word and he would be completely healed. We don't know the reason why God has it, but we do know that he loves him. He is a man of God. He loves you. God is working on your behalf. So let him work. Keep in mind, he knows better than you. Proverbs 14:12 says, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way to death. Guys, I think it's very interesting he said to a man. So we can get ourselves into trouble sometimes, can't we? I can't get this to work. Well, all you got to do is this. But God knows the way. God is in control of life if we give it to him. He doesn't need our advice. He knows what's best. It's hard. I know it's hard. Because this time that we have on earth seems so permanent. But when it comes to eternity, the Bible says this is a vapor. My mom, when she passed away with cancer in her body, I don't say cancer took her. It didn't have the authority to take her. Jesus has the keys of death, hell, and the grave. So when she died with cancer in her body, I've shared with you, I really struggled because my faith was for her healing. That's all I saw, healing now. I have the gift of faith. I believe you can heal. God, heal her. And when he didn't heal her on this earth, I went through a dark time. My thinking got so wrong, I began to blame God for what I thought. You could just do that. And I began to blame him. And this is long before I was a preacher or even a youth pastor. But I quit reading God's word. I walked away from the Bible. Went through a very dark grieving time. The grieving was necessary. But I quit looking to the sun, the S-O-N. And that darkness that should have come to an end, it got worse. I was not able to be the husband I needed to be for Patty. Because my source of comfort was gone. And I told God, I don't read your word no more. Your stuff don't work. Now, I'm talking about, I had been walking with the Lord for some time then. But I was going through it. And the Lord, I was going through deep depression. And I can remember the day that I was in our bedroom with the lights turned off. I wanted no light on. Isn't it amazing how depression does that? You don't want to be around people. You don't want light. It was a darkness. I wanted darkness. That was the devil trying to work in my life, right? Keeping me from the light. And I can remember laying on the floor in the bedroom, so miserable. That's as low as I could go. And in that darkness, God gave me a vision. Even when I told him, your stuff don't work, I don't want to have nothing to do with you, basically, and walked away from it. I don't know who this is for, because this is not in my notes, but we're going to go with this for a moment. Laying on the floor, and I saw a vision. And when I saw a vision, it was a shaft of wheat with a ribbon tied around it. And instantly I knew what that meant. And God let me know that that shaft of wheat was my family that my mama prayed for. I mean, she said, Lord, whatever it takes for my family to be saved. And when I saw those shafts of wheat, I knew instantly it was my family that would be saved. And that bow was my mama's life that represented that, all tied it together so neatly. And just that quick vision restored my relationship with the Lord. I repented. Lord, forgive me. I know now what's beyond this temporary life. My mom is ill. And he said this, cancer did not take your mom. I took her. And that's all I needed. My relationship with the Lord was restored. I began believing again. My faith was restored. God wants to give that to somebody today, that kind of comfort. I believe for cancer to be healed still on this earth. But should that believer find their way to heaven, they're better off than being healed on this earth. Do you agree? I do. And I'm so thankful that she's in heaven. Let's skip Isaiah 40. I want to go with closing, how to survive a bad day. How to survive bad days. We see Paul give us some great instructions. 2 Corinthians is where I'm at. I know I'm skipping quite a bit, guys, but 2 Corinthians verse 1 says this. Paul said, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. How many of you know Paul experienced some great troubles? He said 5 times he received the lashes, the 49 lashes on his back. 5 times. Great troubles. He said, we were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure. Paul said, we can't even endure this. So that we despaired of life itself. Paul said, Lord, I'd rather for you to take me. I can't do this. Take my life. Indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death. This is it. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. So 3 ways, we're going to be looking, I'll read some other scriptures, but 3 ways. The first one is this, 3 ways to find comfort. The first one, refocus on what God wants to do in you. When you're going through trouble, hard times, refocus your thinking on what God wants to do in you. If God has allowed something to happen to you, then God desires to do something in you. God has allowed something bad to happen to you as his child. He wants to do something in you. Someone has said this, my pain is either a jail that imprisons or a school that shapes me. It depends on the way I look at it, my perspective. When facing trouble, we need to pray, God, what do you desire to accomplish in me through this? He wants to show himself to you, maybe in a way that you've never seen him before, and you wouldn't be looking for him that way other than going through what you're going through. But he has something good for you. He loves you. And he has something good planned for you. You can rest in that. Trouble is never in vain unless you never grow from it. So don't think that God has forgotten about you or that he's punishing you from past sins or that he hasn't heard your prayers. You must know that God is working for you, in you, and he wants to work through you to keep that right perspective. Paul said this happened that we would not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. There's a reason. God wants my focus to be more on him. Maybe Paul was getting too secure in who he was in his ministry. But for whatever reason, Paul said, God is doing something here. He wants me to refocus, to rely on him instead of myself. Here's another thing that we can do when trouble comes that we should do, is that we have to remember that God always comes through. Would you say that with me? Remember that God always comes through. He does, every time. Every time. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 1:11, I think I skipped over that. He said, he has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us. Has anybody experienced God delivering you through some trouble? And you have to be sure that he will do it again. That is your evidence that he will do it again for you. The best predictor of God's present help is his past faithfulness. Man, God was faithful to me even when I didn't serve him. He kept me even when I didn't acknowledge him. I think many of you can say the same. That I realized God's hand was on me even when I was not pursuing him. Now the Bible says, along with him, how will he not give me all things? If he was there for me even before I acknowledged him, now that I am living for him, how will he not be here for you today? He always comes through. The next best predictor of God's present help is this, his future promises for you. God's got great plans for you on this earth and in eternity. Revelations 21 says this, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things have passed away. There's coming a day when there will be no more mourning. There will be no more trouble. There will be no more trials, no more tears. All right, the third thing to do when we are facing trouble, and would you stand? I always have you stand on the last one. That means I hurry up. That brother going through a time of trouble, he praises the Lord. So we refocus on what God, when we're facing troubles, we refocus on what God wants to do in us. God, what are you doing in me? If you're facing trouble right now, you want to look to God. Don't look away from him. Don't blame him. You are working yourself into a deeper darkness. Don't question God's love. Don't question, oh, he don't love me as much as he loves somebody. That's the devil speak. That's devil talking to you. But you look to him and say, God, what do you want to do in me? I can tell you this, that if God allows trouble to come your way, the result of him working in you is far greater than if that trouble never came your way. A mature faith is a whole lot greater than never experiencing trouble to begin with. I mean, a mature faith will get you to heaven, right? You've heard me say this. You can be healed and still go to hell. People can get a great healing, and they'll forget about God. So the healing itself, well, sure, we all want that, but that's not the greatest thing. The greatest thing is your character being produced like Christ, your faith growing, your maturity level in Christ. That's valuable. As a matter of fact, the scripture said that's more precious than gold. So we refocus on what God wants to do in us. We remember he always comes through. He loves us. Then the last one is this. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 1:11, as he continues, he said, as you help us by your prayers. Paul said, we believe that God is going to get us through this, and he will continue, but we need your help by your prayers. And he says, then Many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to the prayers of many. The third way to get through hard times is this. Rely on solid, godly relationships. Amen. Rely on solid, godly relationships. We all need somebody to lean on. Somebody's singing it. We all need solid, godly relationships, don't we? It's the reason why your church family is so important. It's the reason why ministry teams, even in a church our size, it'd be easy to sort of get lost and just sort of come in and go without developing strong relationships. But when you begin serving in a ministry team or attend a small group, those relationships get tighter. You have someone to count on. We all need those people. And as Christians, we all should desire to become those people. That I want to be someone, as they shared so great in their testimonies, that we want to be somebody that they can look to and be an example for. I like what Paul says. There was a problem that came in the church of Philippi, came up, and it doesn't go into great detail, but it was a problem with a couple of the ladies that co-labored with Paul, he said. And he was looking for some help in this trouble. And it says in Philippians 4, it says, I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. So there's a disagreement between these two ladies. Verse 3 is the reason why I want to read this. He said, yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Paul addresses this problem to his faithful, true companion. Theologians are really not sure who that true companion is that Paul is writing to, mentioning in this letter to the church of Philippians, but that true companion knows. They know who they are, be it either a male or female. They understand who they are. Paul had someone that he could count on. The great apostle Paul. The Bible don't even mention the name of this true companion. Maybe other references to the Bible, if it mentioned it, that we would know who it is. But maybe they're not even anywhere else in the Bible. But Paul says, you're my true companion. I can count on you. I know you'll help. I can't be there to straighten the situation out, but I can count on you. We need that. Every person in this room, no matter how great you are, no matter how organized your life is, no matter how situations that you could just work out, you still got to have somebody. We all need somebody sometimes. And we all need to work on, God, I want to be that. I don't want to be the one that always needs the help. I want to be the one that can give the help. I want to be the one that somebody else can look to, that I can help them out through their hard time. Amen? Would you bow your head just for a moment? I know this was a different kind of message, more of a teaching. But man, we need those sometimes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Would you just thank the Lord just for his faithfulness to you? If he's proven himself faithful to you, you may be going through it right now. I'm not talking about right now. But if he's proven himself faithful to you in the past, would you just lift up a hand and just give him thanks? Thank you, God. Thank you. I'm raising my hand. Thank you. Thank you that you didn't leave me where I was. You're faithful. You're faithful. We praise you, Lord. You can let your hand down if you would. If you're going through trouble right now, you are going through trouble. Would you lift up your hand? Going through it right now. Just hold it up for just a moment. Lord, you see these hands. You know exactly what they're going through. Lord, help them to have the right perspective in this. Help them to look through to the sun, S-O-N, that this darkness would leave. Father, I know if you got your hand raised, would you go ahead and give it to him? Well, Pastor, I've given it to him already. Let's give it to him one more time. God, I give it to you. Pray you would work it out. Work it out, Lord God. I belong to you, so this problem belongs to you. I ask you to work it out. Do what needs to be done. Now, God, I pray you would give us the right perspective going through it. If they're going through it, give them the right perspective. Not to blame you, but to look to you. And, Father, I thank you for that. In Jesus' name. I want to pray one other prayer before we pray in the salvation prayer. I want to pray for those that are really going through that darkness. Maybe the darkness was started with a grieving time, a mourning time. Look at me for a minute, if you would. But the darkness has lasted too long. And God would want you to know it's time for that darkness to be over with. Yeah, it was a time of grieving, a time of mourning, but it wasn't supposed to last this long. And you keep saying, but if only it would do it, if God would just do it, if only it worked out this way. And God is, he is omnipotent. He doesn't need your help. He knows what needs to happen. And maybe he's waiting for you to come out of that darkness so he can really do what needs to be done. Now, that started out as a prayer request, but ended in being more prophetic. Would you bow your head just for a moment? And you say that I have been in this darkness, and I believe the Lord is speaking to me. I've been here too long. Would you raise your hand without shame whatsoever? And it's time for that to leave. Yes. There's a few more people. Just raise your hand. There's no shame. We're going to ask God to deliver us. There's no shame in this. Father, I thank you. As you're raising your hand, I want you to ask the Lord to bring you back, okay? To bring you back into his light. If you need to repent, I had to repent. Ask him to forgive you. God, I shouldn't have blamed you. I shouldn't have stayed in this. I shouldn't have done it. Would you forgive me? Come on, God's going to do it today. I really believe that. If you just press it and say, God, forgive me. I don't want this darkness. And Lord God, I shouldn't have stayed here. Now, Lord God, show me your light again. Lord God, bring me back into you, your light. Father, I thank you you're doing it. I believe that. Lord God, you're doing it for them now. And I pray joy would come. Lord God, let them feel your joy of your presence. The joy of the Lord is your strength. It's time to smile again. It's time to hope again. It's time to have peace again. It's time to proclaim with your mouth the goodness of the Lord. It's time to speak of his favor on your life. He's not punishing you. It's time to live for him again. Thank you, God. Abundant life. Abundant life. Abundant life. I thank you for that. In Jesus' name. Okay. One last thing, and then we're going to pray our salvation prayer. This is not a prayer, but I feel like I needed to say this. Some of you think you're not capable of being blessed. That's a lie from the pits of hell, okay? You rebuke that lie. If anybody can be blessed, you can. Amen? We're all in Christ. He forgives us. So I just rebuke that for you, and then you're going to rebuke it. You got to do it yourself, but I'm just telling you. You are capable of being blessed. God wants to bless your socks off. Amen. Now, if you've got sin in your life and you don't serve the Lord, you need to go ahead and make that right. All of this is contingent on a relationship with Jesus. And if your relationship with Jesus ain't right, let's take care of this. If you're watching online, let's do it today. The Lord's given you an opportunity. Let's pray at church. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me so much that you gave your son, Jesus, to die on the cross for my sins. I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. Would you forgive me for all my sins? Would you come into my heart? Would you change my life? And I'm going to do my best to live for you in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we just praise the Lord like all of us pray that? Come on. Yes. We're going to do it one more time because this is what I said. Like all of us just did that for the first time. Man, you remember that? Come on, let's thank you for that. Thank you, God. Woo! Man. Yes, man. Thank you, Jesus. All right, just a couple of things, and we will go. Look, dads, if you did not get your sausage and cheese kebab, please go back there. If you did, get you another one, please. I don't want to have the meat sweats from eating all that pork. And the other announcement is this. July the 3rd, Sunday, July the 3rd, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, I'll give you the place, hopefully next Sunday. But we're going to be joining with Journey Church. We have Browers leading up a softball team. They got a practice coming up. They not the bad news bears. They the good news bad boys and ladies, whatever. And, you know, it's not about, if you know, it's about playing the game. But we won't win. So we're going to be joining Journey Church and playing softball with them and have a cookout. It's going to be a great time. So if you're in town, come on out, bring your lawn chairs. It's just be a good time as the body of Christ gets together. And so that'll be July 3rd, Sunday afternoon, 5 o'clock. I'll give you the location next Sunday. Okay, let me bless you before we leave. Raise your hand if you would receive this. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Let's do our part by sharing this video so not only us, but everyone can see. And let's have a great